Hi everybody. In the previous video, we solved for the orbitals and the energies of a hydrogen atom. In this video, I'd like to take a closer look at some of the features of those orbitals, what they look like. First, let's remind ourselves of what the mathematical form of these orbitals is. Each orbital, psi, can be expressed as the product of a radial function, capital R, and an angular function, capital Y, where the radial function has two quantum numbers, n and l, and the angular function has two quantum numbers, L and M sub L. So in total, each hydrogen orbital has three quantum numbers, N, L, and M sub L. And as we saw, there are certain restrictions on what values those quantum numbers can have. N has to be a positive integer, L has to be an integer ranging from 0 to N minus 1, and M sub L has to be an integer ranging from negative L to L. The lowest energy orbital of a hydrogen atom, so the orbital where the electron is in a ground state hydrogen atom, is the 1s orbital, the orbital for which n equals 1 and l equals 0. A hydrogen 1s orbital has the mathematical form shown on this slide. It's a normalization constant times a decaying exponential, e to the negative r over a naught, where a naught is a constant, called the Bohr radius. It's the radius of the lowest energy orbit in the Bohr model of a hydrogen atom. Knowing the mathematical form of a hydrogen 1s orbital, I'd like to spend much of this video thinking about the question of where an electron in a hydrogen 1s orbital is most likely to be found. This question isn't quite as straightforward as it sounds. It actually depends what we mean by where an electron is likely to be found. There are several related questions that we could be asking. We could be asking, where's the most probable point in space for the electron to be found? Or, where is the most probable distance from the nucleus? Or, what would be the average distance from the nucleus over a large number of measurements? Or, what's the distance inside of which there's a 50% chance of finding the electron? Each of these questions is sort of asking for a different type of average position of the electron. In terms of mathematical concepts that you've probably seen before, you can actually think of those last three bullet points as asking the mode, mean, and median distance from the nucleus. The reason why I'd like to spend some time looking at each of these questions in detail is that we know how to solve each of these. And in the process of looking at them, we'll get some important reminders of some quantum mechanical concepts. Let's start with the first question. Where is the most probable point in space of finding the electron in a hydrogen 1s orbital? I'll give you a few seconds to think about that. See if you can figure out mathematically what we're looking for, and if you can figure out what point in space this actually is. In quantum mechanics, we've seen that the probability of finding an object at a given point in space is proportional to the wave function times its complex conjugate, or in most cases where the wave function is real, the square of the wave function. So here, we're looking for the point where psi star times psi is the largest, or alternatively, we can think of that as the point where the absolute value of psi is the largest. We know that a hydrogen 1s orbital is a decaying exponential. At r equals 0, the nucleus of the atom, the decaying exponential term e to the negative r over a naught equals 1. And as r gets larger, that becomes e to a larger and larger negative number, so it gets closer and closer to 0. That means the hydrogen 1s orbital always has a positive value, and its value is largest at r equals 0, at the nucleus. So, if you were to square the wave function, the square of the wave function is also largest at r equals 0. That means the most probable point in space of finding an electron in a hydrogen 1s orbital is at the nucleus, r equals 0. The next question to consider is what is the most probable value of lowercase r for an electron in a hydrogen 1s orbital? In other words, what's the most probable distance from the nucleus where we'll find this electron? I'd like you to think for a few seconds about this, not so much to find the numerical answer, but to understand why this question is different from the previous one. Why is the question of what is the most probable radius different from the question of what's the most probable point? To understand this distinction, we need to think about something called the radial distribution function. And it's easiest to introduce this by analogy. Consider the apple tree that's shown on this slide, from which a lot of apples have fallen. Each individual apple is likely to end up close to the tree and not roll too far away. So the largest density of apples is at r equals 0, near the tree trunk. That's where the apples are closest together. But does that mean r equals 0 is the radius at which we're most likely to find an apple? It turns out that it's not, because the likelihood of finding an apple at a given radius depends not only on the density of the apples, but also on the size of the circle at that radius. As we get farther away from the tree, the circles at a given radius get bigger, and there are just more places of finding an apple. So if we want to think about the likelihood of finding an apple at a given radius, we need to consider not just the density of the apples, but also the circumference of a circle at that radius, the number of different places that an apple can be. Hopefully you remember that the circumference of a circle is 2 pi r, so the function that we want to plot here is 2 pi r times the density of the apples. And you can see on this slide that that function reaches a maximum at a value of r that's not r equals 0. The maximum of this function is sort of a happy medium. It's a place where the density of apples is relatively high, but also the circumference of the circle is relatively large, and there are a lot of places where the apples can be. We can extend the same idea to the 1s orbital of a hydrogen atom. To think about the most likely radius of finding the electron, we need to think about not only the probability density, but also the surface area of a spherical shell at a given radius. When we were thinking about the most probable point of finding an electron, we wanted to maximize psi star times psi. But in order to think about the most probable radius, the function that we want to maximize is psi star times psi times the surface area of a spherical shell, which you may remember is 4 pi r squared. So, we're looking for the largest value of this function, p of r, which is the radial distribution function. We'll solve this numerically in class, but you can at least start to think about how you might find the maximum of a function like this. As is the case when you're looking for the maximum or minimum of any function, it's useful to find the places where the derivative is equal to zero. We won't do the math here, but it turns out that for a hydrogen 1s orbital, the most probable radius is a0, the Bohr radius. This is kind of interesting. The Bohr radius is a value that was found without any quantum mechanics, but it turns out that the Bohr radius does have quantum mechanical significance. It's the most probable radius of finding an electron in a ground state hydrogen atom. The next question we asked was, if we take a large number of measurements, what's the average distance between the electron and the nucleus? I'll give you some time to think about how you would set that up, even though we won't solve it numerically here. Way back at the beginning of the quarter, we talked about the postulates of quantum mechanics, and one of those postulates told us how to find the average over a large number of measurements. It's something called the expectation value, and it's an integral that looks like this: an integral of the complex conjugate of the wave function times the operator that we're interested in applied to the wave function, times the volume element. So in this case, the operator is the radius operator, which we haven't really talked about, but it's just r. And the volume element is what's in parentheses. In Cartesian coordinates, the volume element is just dx, dy, dz. In this case, since we're working in spherical coordinates, we have some extra terms. The volume element, as you can see, is a little bit more complicated when the axes are not all at right angles. We'll talk more about this in class. If you were to solve this integral numerically, you would find that for a hydrogen 1s orbital, the expectation value of r turns out to be 3/2 a0. 3/2 times the Bohr radius. This is a bit larger than a0, which was the most probable radius. In the same way that the mode and the mean can be different for a set of numbers, these two types of average are slightly different. And the last question we asked was, what's the value of r inside of which the electron has a 50% chance of being found? Again, I'll give you some time to think about how to set this up, even though we won't solve it numerically. If we're working with a normalized wave function, we know how to find the probability that the electron will be found in a certain region in space. It's just the integral of that wave function times its complex conjugate. So, if we want to find the radius inside of which there's a 50% probability of finding the electron, we need to integrate the wave function times its complex conjugate up to some radius that we'll call capital R, such that the probability is 1/2. The integral is shown on this slide, again with the volume element and spherical coordinates given in parentheses. So the idea is that we would solve this equation for capital R, such that the probability was 1/2. We're not actually going to do this because it turns out to be very difficult to solve this particular integral with finite bounds of integration. But I did graph this integral to plot the probability of finding the electron inside a given radius as a function of the radius. To answer the question that we asked, we're looking for the point on this plot where there's a 50% chance of finding the electron. That point turns out to be about 1.34 A0, slightly larger than the most probable radius, but slightly smaller than the expectation value. We'll take some more time in class to look more mathematically at each of these questions. So far in this video, we've been talking only about the hydrogen 1s orbital. For the last couple of minutes, I'd like to talk about the other orbitals in a hydrogen atom. Like the 1s orbital, all s orbitals, orbitals for which the quantum number L equals 0, are spherically symmetric. In general, s orbitals have n-1 radial nodes. So while the 1s orbital did not have any radial nodes, the 2s orbital does have one, the 3s orbital has two, etc. Radial nodes, as you can see from this picture, are spherical shells on which there's no chance of finding the electron. Another thing to know about s orbitals is that their size and energy increase as n increases. So going from a 1s to a 2s to a 3s orbital, the orbitals are getting larger, and their energies are getting higher. Next, we'll look at p orbitals, for which the quantum number L equals 1. The p orbitals that you see in this picture each have one angular node, a plane on which there's no chance of finding the electron. P orbitals also have n-2 radial nodes. Because these pictures show two p orbitals, they have no radial nodes. And as was the case with s orbitals, the size and energy of p orbitals increase with increasing n. So when you go from 2p to 3p to 4p orbitals, the orbitals get bigger and they get higher in energy. It's worth pointing out that there's no such thing as a 1p orbital. The reason for that is that a 1p orbital would have n equals 1 and l equals 1. And we know that the value of l has to be less than the value of n. Notice that the way that I phrased this first bullet point is a little bit strange. The p orbitals that you're used to seeing have one angular node. The reason I phrased it that way is that there are different ways of representing p orbitals. Because a set of p orbitals are all eigenfunctions of the energy operator that correspond to the same energy, any sums and differences of those functions are also eigenfunctions. So if you look up in your textbook the wave functions corresponding to L equals 1 and M sub L equals negative 1, 0, or 1, you'll find that the wave functions corresponding to M sub L equals negative 1 and positive 1 are actually complex numbers that don't have angular nodes. The p orbitals that we're used to seeing, px, py, and pz, are actually sums and differences of those functions that you see in your textbook. We'll talk more about this in class. And finally, we can take a look at a set of d orbitals. The d orbitals that you're used to seeing have two angular nodes and n-3 radial nodes. These pictures show the 3d orbitals, so they have no radial nodes. Again, the size and energy of these orbitals increase with increasing n. These 3d orbitals that are shown are the lowest energy d orbitals. Again, it's not possible to have 1d or 2d orbitals, because the value of L has to be less than the value of N. That's all for now. In the next video, we'll go beyond the hydrogen atom and start to think about how we can extend our understanding to atoms with more than one electron.